لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى على أفضلهم وخاتم محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ونزلنا عليك الكتاب تبيانا لكل وهدى ورحمة وبشرى للمسلمين صدق الله العظيم. We begin with Allah's blessed name. We praise Him and we glorify Him. God to be praised and glorified. Pray for peace and for blessings on all His noble messengers and in particular on the last of them, all the blessed prophets. Our subject tonight is a very provocative one. The woman of Islam, the house of Allah. And before we explain the structure of the lecture, let us begin by recalling the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said, three things have been made dear to me in this world of yours: al-'itr, perfume, as fragrance, and there is that fragrance with this faculty of smearing. And there is another fragrance, only some the one of Uwais company, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He had become a Muslim in Yemen. He longed to see the Messenger of Allah. But he had a mother, an old woman, and he begged and begged her for permission until she finally gave him permission. You can go, but you're allowed to spend only 3 days to reach Medina. Then you must come back. But when he reached Medina, Nabi Muhammad was not there. And he waited for 3 days and then he left, broken hearted. A few days later, the Prophet returned to Medina. But on the road coming, what is this fragrance? Where is it coming from? Nobody else can smell it, only he. Only he. We could smell it. When he arrived in Medina, then he was told that Uwais' company, radiallahu, had come and had gone back on the same road. And so that love had been transformed into fragrance, right? And so when he said, three things have been made dear to me in this world of yours, he may not be talking only about this perfume, fragrance. And the second one he said was as-salat. But the third one was Nisa, woman. Because he knew what modern Western civilization does not know, that in the relationship between the male and the female there is that which produces fragrance and which allows a man to scale the heights, intellectual heights and spiritual heights, provided that the woman is a woman. provided that the woman is still a woman. It is with this hadith that we want to begin our subject tonight. This lecture may not, you may not see the relevance of it today, but I tell you, 20 years and 30 years from now, you remember this lecture tonight. 20, 30 years from now, I anticipate there will be a masjid built for women only. We don't want any men in this masjid. The reason why we built our own masjid is because you denied us the rights of Allah gave to us in your masjid. And they'll be quoting the very same ahadith that I'll be quoting here tonight. And in that masjid for women only, a woman will be the imam. And she will be on the minbar and she'll give the khutbah. And when that happens, you remember this lecture tonight. In the first part of the lecture, we will look at the world today and what is going to come tomorrow, as anticipated by the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. In respect of the world of women, something strange happening in the world of women. And in the second part of the lecture, and I hope you will not be upset with me with the second part, we will look at the rights that Allah gave to women, the women of Islam, in the house of Allah. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam said, and you know, prophets speak with only a few words, and it takes us a long time, I tell you, to understand all that he's saying. It comes out slowly, years and years and years. He said one of the signs of the last day would be that women would dress like men. Oh, I heard that many years ago. But it took years for it to mature, for me to understand. Why would women dress like men? Oh, the reason why women are dressing like men is because a time will come when they will seek to assume the functional role of men in society. What is the functional role of men in society? Modern Western civilization says there is no functional role of men in society that is exclusive to men. Everything in society is open to both men and women. But not so in Islam. Allah speaks in the Quran, in Surah An-Nisa, and He says, "الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ إِلَى آخِرِ الْآيَةِ." Ayah number 34. That Allah has appointed men to be guardians over women. Today's modern woman rejects that. I don't want any guardian. A guardian is one who is responsible for the maintenance of the woman. Oh, I don't want anybody to maintain me. I want to be economically independent. But this is what Allah has said. Don't be angry with me. I'm just telling you what Allah has said. The one who created you from a drop of sperm. So please listen. That men shall be responsible for maintaining women, that does not mean that a woman cannot be in business.
Yes, she can employ a man. He has to work for her. She's paying him a salary. I know somebody like that. He was working for a woman whose name was Khadija, radiallahu ta'ala anha. He was a man. Yeah. But men must maintain women. Meaning, to the extent that a woman needs to be maintained. But if she says, I don't need, I have enough, you don't have, I can share with you. That promises. And men must guard and protect women. This is the function that Allah gave to men. And so when women dress like men, the implication is that they want to overturn this functional role of men that Allah gave in the Quran. And so now the process starts for a woman to assume all the functional roles that men had in society. Who is the mastermind behind this? This is going to turn the world upside down. Nabi Muhammad said that the last people to come out of Dajjal will be women. And a man will have to return to his home and tie down, coercively restrain his wife, sister, and daughter to protect them from Dajjal. Talking precisely about something which will come and seek to sweep the world of women off their feet. Presenting to them something that looks like heaven for women, when in fact it will be hell itself. And so the mastermind who wants women to dress like men is Dajjal. Is she dressing like that now? Oh yes. When she goes to work, you see her in a jacket, and the trousers, sometimes a tie. You will find her as the police officer. Yes. You'll find her in the military as an officer in the armed forces. Yes. You'll find her in government. And there will be a certain number of seats in parliament reserved for women. And then you'll find people talking about what percentage of your cabinet is women. And then, well, why not? She can be the head of state as well. She can be a Margaret Thatcher. But the last place that they're going to seek to penetrate is religion, because that's trouble. So you'll eventually see a woman as a priest. And you'll see her as a rabbi. And I heard the term for the first time in my life. I know about pandit, but I never heard pandita. And I heard it. And so it is inevitable. It is just a matter of time. Wait and you will see it. There will be women of Dajjal who will seek to become imam and deliver the khutbah. When that time comes, and it is going to come, what those women of Dajjal would do would be to exploit every mistake that we make. Every mistake that we make will open a door for them. And you may not be around to see it, but your sons will face the music tomorrow. Why did my grandfather, why did my father create this opportunity for them? In anticipation of that day, we're telling you tonight, what are the rights of women in the house of Allah? When we know what are the rights of women in the house of Allah, if those rights are now denied to her, don't react with anger towards the speaker. No. Rather, weep for tomorrow that is coming. Because so long as you deny her those rights in the house of Allah, it is as certain as the sun rises in the east that she is going to exploit that tomorrow to build a masjid for women only. And when she starts quoting these ahadith that we will be quoting tonight, 20 years from now, your daughters are going to be swept. And your daughters are going to flock to that masjid where a woman will be on the minbar giving the khutbah and leading the salah. That is the context in which we are giving this talk tonight. This hadith is in Sahih Muslim. Nobody can take it out. It is still there. What did the Prophet say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, أَحْسَنُ الصُّفُوفِ لِلْرِجَالِ أَوَّلُهَا وَشَرُّهَا آخِرُهَا وَأَحْسَنُ الصُّفُوفِ لِلنِّسَاءِ آخِرُهَا وَشَرُّهَا أَوَّلُهَا. The best row for the men, meaning in the masjid, is the first. And the worst, the one with the greatest potential for evil, shar means evil, is the last. And the best row for the woman, meaning in the masjid, not inside their home, no, in the masjid, that's the meaning of Saf. The best row for the woman is the last. And the worst, the one with the greatest shar, and shar means evil, danger, is the first. These are the words of he from whom we get the religion of Islam, who is the only authority. Hello, the only authority Allah sent him to deliver Islam to us. What does this hadith mean? We can understand that the first rule for the men is the best rule. But we don't understand this one about the last row being evil. And when he says that the last row is the best for the woman, it looks as though he's talking about women performing salat in the masjid. Oh, are women allowed to perform salat in the masjid? Isn't it strange that around the world today there are many, many, many masajid where it is prohibited for women to come and pray? In my island of Trinidad, a wealthy family built a masjid. And a woman from that family came one day to perform salat. She's a businesswoman. She just wanted to perform salat and leave quickly. She went to the last row and stood up. to perform salah. A man came up in front of her and started shouting at her, "Get out of the masjid. Women are not allowed in this masjid." The woman continued to perform her salah, ignoring the man. For the entire time that she was performing her salat, he kept on shouting, "Get out of this masjid. Women are not allowed in this masjid." When she was finished with her salat, she made salams, did not wait to make dua, she got up and she left very quietly, without speaking to the man. This happened in my island of Trinidad. From where did we get this, that women are not allowed in the masjid? In the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there must have been conditions of grave insecurity. And since men are the guardians of a woman, a woman cannot leave her home unless her guardian is satisfied that she is safe. And so you can prohibit your wife from coming to the masjid. Of course you can do that. But that will be because of conditions of insecurity. Yes. But that cannot be a permanent ban. Because if you make it a permanent ban, then you have changed the religion. Because from this hadith we know that women came to the masjid for salah. And Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has himself said specifically, do not prohibit women from coming to the masjid for salah. You can say to your wife, it's better for you to pray at home, but if she says, I want to come to the masjid as the wife of Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he is the Khalifa, and she wants to come to the masjid, he could not stop her. Why don't you stop me, she said. Amirul Mu'mineen, why don't you stop me? She used to say to him. He could not. Because she had the right to come. Because Allah's Messenger gave her the right. The only time he could stop her is if there are conditions of insecurity. And even now, right here in Mitchell's Place, if there are conditions of insecurity, you can tell your woman to stay at home. Not allowed to come in the masjid. You can do it now. And so if women are banned from coming to the masjid, you change religion. What is going to be your fate on the Day of Judgment? Hadith is in Sahih Bukhari, but in two forms, both of which are dangerous. That it will be very hot on the Day of Judgment. Heat will be terrific. And we'll be very thirsty. But the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam will be coming to him, and he will be standing by Al-Kawthar, the spring of water, and he'll be offering water to members of his Ummah. But there will be some who would come to him and he would refuse to give them water. And they will say, "O Messenger of Allah, we are Muslims. We are members of your Ummah." He will say, "But you changed your religion after I left. No water for you today." That is one form of the hadith. The other one is worse than that. In the other form, it is Allah who instructs him, don't give them any water. Allah who instructs him, don't give them any water. because they changed the religion. The worst place to change your religion
is in the house of Allah.
And if you prevent women from coming to the house of Allah without a valid reason, like for example conditions of rioting and anarchy and so on, without valid condition, you prevent women, you make it a permanent ban, you change your religion. So now, okay, if you've denied her that right, and tomorrow the masjid is built for women only, you won't cry on that day, but you'll deserve what you got, because they're going to exploit the ban on women coming to the masjid on that day. But what about if we allow her to come to the masjid? Then what is this about the last row of the men being the one with the greatest evil, and the first row of the women being the one with the greatest evil? This is Sahih Muslim, did I tell you that? Did I tell you that this hadith is in Sahih Muslim? Did I say it?
Yes.
I did? Well then it is Sahih. Alright? Nobody can take it out of Sahih Muslim now, too late. You have to deal with this hadith. The only way we can understand this hadith, the only way it will have any meaning, is because the women were praying behind the men. That's the only way. The women were praying behind the men. They were not praying in an annex. They were not praying in the basement. They were not praying in an upstairs gallery. They were not praying at the side. In Trinidad, all my life I grew up with a screen in the masjid, and women on one side and men on the other side. And as a boy I could remember, sometimes the first row of the men might have to go back one row or come forward one row. So the imam would call out to the women to inform them so that they could remain in the same row, go back or come forward. So men and women were praying in one saf with a piece of cloth in between. This is what I grew up with. If any of these things prevail, then we have in fact denied woman the right that Allah gave to her. And Nabi Muhammad has spoken of in this hadith that women must pray at the back and men at the front. So Wednesday night we had the Christian Muslim dialogue at the University of Cape Town. The bishop, the Christian bishop, introduced me to his wife. So she put out her hand. So I said, excuse me, we don't shake hands, but we give you a nice smile. Excuse me, we don't shake hands, but I'll give you a nice smile. And she liked it. As soon as I did that, somebody else came and put out his hand for shaking her hand. A Muslim. She's puzzled. And she withdrew her hand. She didn't shake hands with him. She didn't shake hands with him. So I said to the bishop, here we are, we're going to perform salat now. And you can see the sheets arranged there. And the women are going to pray at the back and the men at the front. So the wife of the bishop is querying why the women at the back. What answer to give? So I said, well, if the women are at the front and the men at the back, the men won't be able to concentrate. So the bishop stroked his head He says, yes, I can understand that. The men won't be able to concentrate if the woman at the front. It makes sense, doesn't it? So by putting the woman at the back, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not giving to the woman an inferior position. No. She can perform her salah with men in front of her. And she can concentrate. But we cannot perform our salah with women in front of her. We won't be able to concentrate. But why the evil? If the woman at the back and the men are at the front, why is it that the last row of the men have the most evil and the first row of the women have the greatest shar? Because that's the hadith I quoted for you. There's only one way to understand that. Only one. And that is that as the row of men keep on going backwards, and the rows of the women keep on coming forward, eventually they will approach each other and be close to each other. And because of the physical proximity of men and women, there are sparks which fly when men and women are close to each other. That's where the danger lies. Oh, I see. Well, that means that there was no barrier between the men and women. Because if you put up a barrier between the men and the women, then there will be no physical proximity. They will not be drawing close to each other. And therefore you can take this hadith and put it in the cold storage. Yeah, take this hadith and put it in the cold storage. Because there is no longer any question of shar. That's common sense. So that means that in the time of the Prophet men and women perform their salah in the masjid, number one. Men prayed at the front and women prayed at the back, number two. There was no barrier between the men and the women, number three. And therefore the conclusion is that men and women prayed in the same space, not in two separate spaces, in the same space, with the men at the front and the women at the back. But that's not all. There's more. You may not have ever heard it, because this hadith has been put into the cold storage of the fridge. It's no longer relevant today. What is it? He said, when you go down in sijda, the woman must remain in sijda longer than the men. You never heard this, did you? Never heard it. It's there. Some of you are shaking your heads. When you go down in sijda, in salat in the masjid, the woman must remain in sijda longer than the men. Because a man may not have enough cloth to cover his private parts. I was teaching this subject to the woman, so when I came to this part, I just said, may not have enough cloth to cover himself, but because you are men in front of me, I can give you the hadith as it is. A man may not have enough cloth to cover his private parts, and when he goes down in sijda, if the woman raises her head too quickly, then this sight would be there before her, which is inappropriate. And so he commanded the woman to remain in sijda longer than the men. Do not raise your head at the same time that the men are raising their head. This is the religion of Islam that came from Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And the religion of Islam comes from him. There is only one way that we can understand this hadith. And that is that when women prayed at the back of men, if a woman raised her head too quickly, that there will be no barrier between her and the men. None. And therefore, she could see that the man is not fully covered. So she is praying with both her ears and her eyes. If you put a barrier between the men and the women, or if you put the woman in the basement, or in an annex, or in an upstairs gallery, tell me why should she remain in sijda longer than men? Give me one good reason why we should take that hadith out of the cold storage where we put it now, having changed the religion. Do you see the storm that is coming 20, 30 years from now? Are you seeing what they're going to be arguing right here in Cape Town? You might be in your grave sleeping, so you wouldn't witness that storm, that evil storm that will sweep away Cape Town. But your son will be there. And what you're doing is digging a grave for your own children tomorrow. Where the woman will be quoting these ahadiths that I'm now quoting. And the woman are going to be saying, you denied us our rights in the house of Allah. And so what could we do? We're going to build our own masjid for women. And a woman will be on the minbar. And she'll give the khutbah. She'll lead the salah. You can't stop her. Because you opened the door for Dajjal to exploit this opportunity. I used to conduct the Salat at the United Nations headquarters in Manhattan for 10 years, Salatul Jummah. And the Secretary General of the UN gave us the biggest hall in the whole building. The hall could accommodate about 600 people. But the only entrance to the hall was from the front where the Imam stands in Salat. We had the back rows for the women and the front for the men. And there used to be maybe about two rows of women. But the place used to be packed every Jummah. And some people don't, can't get inside, they have to perform their Salat in the corridor. And there was no barrier between men and women. And when the Imam got up to give the khutbah, the women could see him. And when the Salat was taking place, the women would be praying with both their ears and their eyes. Sometimes the Imam may recite an ayah of the Quran, which is an ayah of sijda. And he may not mention it before the Salat began. But the men, when they see the Imam go down, they know it's an ayah of sijda. So they all go down. But the women can't see. And they're puzzled, what kind of strange thing going on in the Salat? Something different. Because they didn't know it was a sijda of tilawah. So in the United Nations we did not have any partition. But we had a problem. This was the problem. The Prophet said, when the Salat is over, we must remain sitting. Let the woman leave. Even if you have several entrances to the masjid, let the man keep sitting so the woman can leave. Have you ever heard that in your lifetime in Cape Town? Any imam in Cape Town telling the man keep sitting, let the woman leave first? Never heard it, eh? Alright, well, this is Islam. The problem of the United Nations is that the woman was at the back and there's only one entrance. So the woman had to wait until all the men left and then the woman would leave. Alright. There is a very famous event which occurred in our history. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu is not a man you want to tangle with. Oh no. With Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, you could take your chance. He's a very soft and gentle person. Even with Nabi Muhammad alayhi salam, one day the Prophet alayhi salam was sitting with the woman, teaching them. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu came and knocked. Who is it? Umar! The woman all fled. The woman picked up her dresses and they ran, hiding, hiding behind. And he came in and he saw what happened. And he was angry with them. You fear me? You don't fear him? They said, he's nice with us. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, he's nice with us, we're comfortable with him, we're afraid of you. So even the men are also scared of Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Not only the men, the Prophet said about Umar radiallahu ta'ala, إِذَا سَلَكَ فَجًّا سَلَكَ الشَّيْطَانُ فَجًّا أَخَرْ.
When one takes one road, Shaitan takes another road. When Umar takes one road, Shaitan takes another road. إِذَا سَلَكَ فَجًّا سَلَكَ الشَّيْطَانُ فَجًّا أَخَرْ. So, you don't tangle with Umar. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu is Khalifa, Amir al-Mu'mineen.
And he's disturbed because the mahar, the dowry given to a woman at the time of marriage, is increasing too high, too high. And he decided, I have to put a cap on it, put a limit. So he got up on the mimbar and he gave a khutbah on the subject. And he said, oh people, I'm giving you this order, that from now on, 400 dirhams, plural of dirhams is darahim. 400 darahim is now the limit. No one will give a dowry bigger than this. Then he got down from the mimbar to conduct the salah. A woman got up. She's sitting at the back. She got up. She said, Umar, you cannot do that. If you had dropped a pin, you could hear it. No man would dare to say such a thing. A woman gets up and challenges Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This is trouble. He turned around, he looked at her. He didn't say, woman, what are you doing in the house of Allah? He didn't say, woman, what are you doing at the back of the men? He didn't say, woman, how come you're talking in the house of Allah? He asked her, why not? So she had the right to be in the house of Allah. She had the right to be at the back of the men with no parda, no barrier, no screen, nothing. She had the right to even get up and speak in the house of Allah once the khutbah had ended. So he asked her, why not? And then she quoted the verse of the Quran in which Allah says, when you divorce woman, even if you give her a kintar, a dowry, and kintar is about 1200 dinars, far in excess of 400 dirhams. Even if you give her a kintar, don't take it back. So Allah is saying in the Quran, it is permissible to give a kintar. And you are saying you are not allowed to do it. So Umar stroked his beard. In those days men used to wear beards. He stroked his beard. And he said, everybody have more knowledge than Umar. He said, everybody have more knowledge than Umar. So he was going this way to leave the salat. He turned around, went back up the minbar. Oh people, I just gave that order, I now cancel it. And so this was the status, and this was the place, and this was the role of women in the house of Allah at the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. It is reported, as I said to you earlier, that subsequently conditions of grave insecurity emerged, and he is reported to have prevented the woman from coming to the masjid, but that was temporary. That was not ever meant to be permanent. But if you make it a permanent ban, you would now change the religion. And if you change the religion, you're not going to get any water from Kausar on the Day of Judgment. What is the price that women will pay if they follow a misguided leadership tomorrow? A woman coming to them and telling our daughters tomorrow, look at what the men have done. I'm quoting all the hadiths that we have quoted here. They've denied us our rights. These men, they have put us out of the masjid. They have put us to pray in a basement. They put us in an annex. They put us in an upstairs gallery. And when they allow us to pray on the same floor with them, they put a barrier. This is a denial of our rights. And so now let us take action, affirmative action. And what we want to do is go and build our own masjid. And in our masjid, a woman will give the khutbah. And she will lead the salah. So we teach those men a lesson. We want our daughters who are present here tonight to prepare themselves to respond to such women. Tell them that when Allah created the male and the female, He created them the way He created the night and the day. He says so in Surah Al-Layl. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَى وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا تَجَلَّى وَمَا كَذَقَ وَمَا خَلَقَ الذَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْثَى. In fact, he didn't have to say the next ayah because it is already implicit. إِنَّ سَعَيَكُمْ لَشَتَّى is already implicit. That men and women are functionally different. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the day and He describes the night, and therefore the male And the female, he said, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا وَجَعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَاشًا. That the day is meant to work, and therefore to maintain the women and children. But about the night, he said, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا. That the night is a covering. And so long as a woman is covered, and if she is covered, she is secluded. She's not in the gaze of the public. As long as a woman is libas, she will remain a woman. And when the Prophet said, three things have been made dear to me in this world of yours. And he spoke about woman and salat. The link between woman and salat is the link between woman and spiritual growth. Because salat is the vehicle of spiritual growth. As-salatu mi'rajul mu'min. Nothing in the world can match a woman. Nothing in the world. Insofar as male spiritual growth is concerned, insofar as male intellectual growth is concerned, she is the key. And this is why all through history, men have always been in plural marriages, always, always, always. For the first time in history, with this strange and mysterious civilization that has come from the Jewish-Christian alliance, for the first time in history, we are told a man must have only one wife. When a man is involved in plural marriages, then the multiplicity of wives increases his vitality, increases his versatility, increases his capacity to demonstrate courage of the battlefield. That's what woman does to a man. But the only way she can act as a key to unleash, listen to my words carefully, the only way a woman can act as a key to unleash new worlds of energy in a man, new worlds of vitality, new worlds of versatility, new capacity for intellectual growth, new capacity for spiritual growth, is if she's a woman. As she begins to put her assets on display, he said that women will dress like men, but he also said that women will be dressed and will yet be naked. As she puts her assets on display in public, she loses her femininity. She loses her fertility. But she also loses her sexuality. There are parts of this subject it is better that I deal with it in writing rather than in a public lecture. But it is vitally important that we understand what Dajjal is doing. He is giving to her a road which looks like the road to progress. But at the end of the day, she is no longer a woman. She can no longer function, even sexually, she can no longer function as that magic touch that brings a man to life. Because she is moving in the direction of frigidity, losing her sexuality. And so as a woman moves in that direction to take over from men, the armed forces, the police service, the judiciary, and then finally the minbar, Our daughters must say to her, you are destroying yourself as a woman. We are not going to follow you. We are going to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This lecture is a shorter one than the one you've normally been accustomed to. But that does not mean it is any less important. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may so guide us that we may start to take corrective action, to correct mistakes that we make, so that that day would not come when you have to remember this lecture and say to ourselves, you know, somebody did come and tell us that this is what's going to happen if we stay with the denial of rights to women in the house of Allah that Allah gave to them. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين آمين. عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها, who was leading an army shortly after the death of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. The world of Sunni Islam is already agreed upon. Four of the successors of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam as al-Khulafa al-Rashidun, rightly guided, these are the best. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And so at the time when Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu was assassinated, and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu was appointed the Khalifa, it was the duty of all to submit to his authority. And anyone who raised the standard of revolt against him would not be in the right, it would be in the wrong. And so we cannot declare of the decision of our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha in rejecting the authority of the Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu to have been rightly guided on this issue. But even so, we still recognize her to be a teacher of this ummah. Any other questions? Yeah.
Questions from the ladies.
Okay. And the question is with reference to hijab in the Quran. The Quran speaks about women wearing their head coverings over their bosoms. It does not say that the head has to be covered. Is there any other verse of the Quran which further explains this matter of covering of the head? If you want to know what the verse of the Quran means, and the Quran itself does not make it sufficiently plain to you, what do you do? The Quran declares that Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam was sent لِيُعَلِّمُكُمُ الْكِتَابِ, to teach you the book. And so this is known as usul tafsir, the principles regulating the explanation of the Quran, usul tafsir. And when the Quran itself does not explain itself, Then the next source is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what does he say on the subject in explaining the Quran? Asma radiallahu ta'ala anha came into the home while the Prophet was in the home, and she was wearing clothing which was transparent. And he turned his face away and he said, Asma, when a girl reaches the age of puberty, nothing must be seen of her body except this, and he pointed to the face, and this, and he pointed to the hands. This statement of the Prophet is explanatory of the Quranic guidance, crystal clear, without any room for any ambiguity. The problem would be for those who have an insufficient knowledge of usul tafsir, and that is the principles regulating the explanation of the Quran. In usul tafsir, the first principle is that the Quran explains itself. The second is that the Prophet explains the Quran, and then there are others after that. During the Khilafat of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, I think the women during one period were not allowed to make the tawaf around the Kaaba. Could you please shed some light on the reason why? I have no knowledge of this subject at all. Any other questions? Yes.
I'm asking this question so that we all can benefit, but especially the women, regarding marriage. Is it permissible, or should the man ask permission from his wife to marry another woman?
Well, I just made it difficult for you all. I just made it difficult for you all. I made a promise to my wife, and I have absolutely no regrets of having made that promise. I did it freely. She never asked me to make the promise. No. And there was no obligation on my part to make the promise. It was done freely. I made a promise to her that I'd never take another wife without her permission. And I did that because of something that happened, in which I felt so proud, so proud, so proud of the way in which she had acted. But you don't have to make that promise. And your wife should not ask it of you to make that promise. If you want to make the promise, it's for you. You're free to do that. But when you give your word, you must keep your word. No, there is no obligation on a man to seek permission from anyone, even from Amirul Mu'mineen, from anyone, from any government, from any law, if he wants to take another wife. He must, however, ensure that the marriage is contracted in public, not in private, so that the world would know, the community would know, this is my wife. Men like the sunlight, rats like the dark. Number two, that if he wants to take a second or a third or a fourth wife, he must have the means to maintain them. Number three, that when he takes a second or a third or a fourth wife, he must strive to the best of his ability to establish equity in his relations with his wives. Do not give to one wife and don't give to the other. Once he does that, he is on the right path. If he contracts his marriage in private and his wife does not know about it, then that is something shameful, very shameful. So she will be informed about it, but she does not, you do not need to seek her consent. Any other question? Yes?
We know that in the past the women took part in battles, for example, bin Hawla, bin Hadar, bin Hawla, you killed many men, fighting.
Yes.
That at the time of Omar, he had appointed a woman as market inspector.
That he appointed a woman as?
Market inspector.
Market inspector.
Yes, that's in the book of Hamidullah.
Yes. I'm not aware of this, go ahead.
Anyway, so women have worked in the time even of the Khulafa Rashidin and have fought in the military. They have fulfilled the role of men. And we know that in Shenzhen, the women are fighting the Russians. So would then that go against your view on women?
Those who believe that I am wrong, and there's evidence to the contrary, and that in Islam Allah has not appointed for men a functional role different from women, if this is your opinion, you don't have to follow what I've said. I think I have spoken with clarity, and I have used verses of the Quran to establish my position very clearly. So an incident in history here or an incident in history here cannot take the Quran and turn it upside down. No. الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ is as crystal clear as the daylight. An incident here or an incident there, some of which I never even heard about, cannot take the Quran and turn it upside down. No. The functional difference of men and women is established as clearly as the daylight in the Quran. And it is Dajjal's mission when he says that women will be dressed like men, to have women seeking to assume the functional role of men. A woman can be a businesswoman. I think I mentioned it. And a man could be working for her as her employee. I think I mentioned that. She would be his boss. And I mentioned the name of one such woman who had an employee working for her. But that does not reverse the functional role of the male in society. Now, she is still subject to the authority of her husband. Any other questions?
This
announcement.
Bismillah.
The Muslim there is a card looking on the 1471. That's a wonder of the Imam of the Imam of the
Okay. The question pertains to the punishment in Islam for zina. What is the punishment in Islam for zina? That is a subject which is a little bit removed from our topic for tonight, which is the woman of Islam in the house of Allah. So let us try to first address this subject. Yes.
Regarding the hadith which states that when women rule, men should garner them. Can you elaborate?
There is one hadith about the rule of a woman. لَيَفْلَحْ قَوْمًا وَأَمَرَتْهُ إِمْرَأَةٌ وَلَوْ أَمَرَتْهُ إِمْرَأَةٌ. That society would not prosper in which there is a rule of a woman. I have written an essay on this subject. Perhaps it is outside. There's a book entitled signs of the last day in the modern age. And in that book, this subject is dealt with. Can Muslims choose a woman to rule over them? Number one. And tonight's lecture as well. The woman of Islam in the house of Allah, that subject is also written out as an essay in that book. No, Islam does not permit the rule of a woman over men. Now, any other questions? Or shall we? Yes?
Yeah, another one. I'm looking at the evolving roles and responsibilities of women, particularly in the advancement of technology and how their behavior changes. What's your comment on TV as a medium of perhaps the job and service and those kind of things changing the structure of women's role?
Television certainly has its benefits, but Dajjal is very skillful. He gives you something in which there is manifest benefit so that you have to accept it. But then he put in a little piece of 5% of poison. So as you take the 95% of the apple and you eat it, you'll also get the 5% of the poison in you. Taliban in Afghanistan banned television. And it didn't work. Because as soon as Taliban was pushed aside, the Afghan people hungrily returned to television. So it appears to me, and of course, only Allah does not make mistakes, that the better way to deal with the problem would be to effect some control over television so that we can benefit from it when it is beneficial and be protected from it when it is harmful. How to do that? I think the worst way would be to establish a censorship. And the best way would be self-censorship. So if we are blessed, inshallah, to establish the Muslim village, we would ban television from the home. No televisions in the home. But in the same way, like you have what is known as the internet cafe. So the village would have a common room where there are television sets, and those who would like to come and watch television can come in the common room. But whatever you are seeing, others will be seeing. And when you see something on the television set about which you even have doubt in your hearts that this is haram, you will yourself go and change the channel rather than have someone come to you and tell you this is haram. So in this way, we would not be accused in the village of imposing a censorship, but rather the people themselves would be self-censoring themselves. About the role of women in society, so long as a woman has the permission of her husband to work outside the home, so long as she is in hijab, so long as the work that she is doing is not haram, so long as she conducts herself in public in a manner which conforms with the norms of conduct of Islam, and so long as the prohibited space between a man and a woman is not violated, then she commits no sin. However, you do not go outside to work and have a slave in the home to take care of the home. You know, the black woman the black woman, the African woman, and she's paid the salary of her dog. It is, of course, the salary of her dog. If your daughter will not work for it, and no woman in your social circle will work for that salary, none. You know it. If your daughter will not work for that salary, and if no woman in your social circle will work for that salary, then that's the salary of a dog. You're oppressing her. You're oppressing her. Instead of oppressing her, I have said marry her. If you marry her, and you have children with her, and then you use her family, which now becomes your family. You use your family to reach out to help the poor woman of her community. Remember the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that one man would have to maintain how many women? Huh? Come on, say it a little louder, no? Yes, one man would have to maintain 50 women. He's talking about these women. The ones who are exploited, the ones who are oppressed. In Singapore, our daughters from Indonesia have to serve those who are hostile to Islam, the ruling tribe. They have to cook pork. Yeah. They have to serve pork. Yeah. Sometimes they have to eat pork. Yeah. They have to work full time, no holiday. None. Some of them even have to work with their wombs, which is why many of them commit suicide by throwing themselves off the high-rise buildings. And at the end of the month, they're paid the salary of a dog. So marry her. And if you marry her, and you use her family as a means for which to reach out to the poor, to help them, the woman, in particular the woman, then tomorrow when the bloodbath comes to this country, it has come. It's coming. Because the Prophet said, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, he said, if you have land, hold on to your land. He's talking about this age. If you have animals, hold on to your animals. And then a man asks, O Messenger of Allah, what about if I have no land and no animals? In this country he will say, O Messenger of Allah, they took away my land. And they never gave it back. Nelson Mandela's constitution is a different matter. I never got back my land. They still have it. O Messenger of Allah, what about if you have no land and no animals, what do you do? He said, sharpen your sword. If people want to condemn Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam for that statement, that's their business. But these are his words, sharpen your sword. And they are going to sharpen their sword in this country one day. And when they do sharpen their swords in this country one day, then the enemies of Islam are going to bring all the money they have to pay mercenaries to go and attack the Muslims. You do it. What do? You remain sitting ducks at that time, as you were in Sri Lanka. If you sit down and do nothing, you'll be wiped out. If you sit down and do nothing. But if you follow this advice, then the poor of this country would say, welcome to Islam. We now have Islam in this country. Look what Islam is doing. The government can't do it. And the poor will then protect you and save you. So she can work. But on the condition that she does not have a slave in the house. Pay the salary of a dog. So take care of the home while she is at work. Any more questions?
Doesn't that apply to all colonized countries?
All foreigners in this country?
All colonized countries. Their land was taken away.
If a colonizer decolonizes, and having decolonized, the indigenous people of the country are embraced. And eventually there is no distinction between the two. We all now constitute one fraternity. And nobody can recognize who is colonizer and who is colonized. Then the problem is resolved. But when you have decolonization, and the land still remains with the colonizer, and the indigenous people remain without land, miserably poor, and that situation persists like that, then you have a recipe for disaster. Yeah. Most of our women are working today. What is the role of a man if he's at home or if he's unemployed? I know a case in Trinidad, husband and wife. The wife is my dear student. They have 8 children. 8, mashallah. They both attended George Washington University. They both did the master's degree. When she is going in the morning shift, he is doing the babysitting. And when he goes in the afternoon shift, she is doing the babysitting. So the management of a family, to the extent that either partner has the time to devote to it, is a joint effort. Taking care of children is a joint effort. But if a man is employed outside of the home and it is his responsibility to maintain the home, not hers, and she says, I want to pursue a career, she can't say, well, you must stay home. Let me go and work. Because Allah did not appoint her to maintain the family, he appointed him to maintain the family. Okay? If he's unemployed and he cannot get a job, and she is working and she's maintaining the family temporarily until he can get a job, sure, they can work out an arrangement whereby he is helping out in the home. But that's a temporary arrangement. This is a good topic for women. Unfortunately, no technical provisions were made for women to ask questions. This is precisely the problem. If tomorrow there is a masjid where the men are at the front and the women at the back for salah, as it was in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, with no barrier, you can perform your salah in that masjid confident in your heart that there is a greater likelihood that your salah would be accepted. Should you not go? Should you not go to perform your salat in a place where the likelihood is greater that your salat would be accepted? Then to perform your salat in a place where the system of salat as given by the Prophet has been changed. So not only women but men should look for such a masjid, and when you find such a masjid, go there. If only to be great, to have greater assurance in your heart that your salat would be accepted. In such a masjid, the woman can ask a question. She can ask a question. Because in the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, she got up and she asked the question, is her husband allowed to stay angry with her wife for more than a week? Difficult question, huh? I believe, I cannot remember the hadith clearly, that the Prophet spoke of 3 days. And he didn't say whether it's man and woman, two Muslims, whether it be male and female or husband and wife, 3 days. So if after 3 days you're still not talking with each other, I suggest you make a nice hot cup of coffee and give it to him. To answer this question, we need a certain usul tafsir. That the Quran is the supreme authority in Islam. And the hadith is explanatory to the Quran. But if there is even the appearance of a conflict between the Quran and the hadith, it is in the Quran we must remain. If there is even appearance of a conflict between the Quran and the hadith, it is with the Quran that we must remain. Unfortunately, this usul tafsir, this principle, is the problem, because this is not sufficiently accepted, that in a conflict between the Quran and the hadith, or the appearance of a conflict between the Quran and the hadith, we stay with the Quran until the conflict is resolved, if it can be resolved. Secondly, in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 106, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ما ننسخ من آية أو ننسها نأتي بخير منها أو مثلها. We do not cancel, we do not abrogate any ayah or cause it to be forgotten, but we replace it by that which is better or similar. Could he have been talking about verses of the Quran? That he could cause a verse of the Quran to be forgotten? Is it possible that Allah could be talking about verses of the Quran, that he can cause verses of the Quran to be cancelled, you know, revising it, editing it? This is first draft, this is second draft of the Quran. Or that he could cause some verses of the Quran to be forgotten, aw nunsiha, forgotten. There is nothing in the ahadith of the Prophet to support such a conclusion, that Allah Ta'ala caused some verses of the Quran to be cancelled and replaced with others, or some verses to be forgotten in the Torah, and establishes a new Qibla. When he did this cancellation, it was done completely, not part-time. Then you can have the new Qibla sometimes, but sometimes you go back to the old Qibla. No. When Allah cancels, he cancels, complete, replaces it, complete. Second example. He cancelled the old law of fasting. The old law of fasting in the Torah was from sunset to sunset. No food, no drink, no sexual relations. He cancelled that and he replaced it with a new law in the Quran. And the new law is, you'll fast for the month of Ramadan, you'll fast from dawn to sunset. During the night you can eat, during the night you can drink. أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ رَفَثُ إِلَى نِسَائِكُمْ. You can go to your wives. When Allah cancelled the old law, He did not do it part-time. He did not say that the new law will operate for a certain measure, but the old law is still valid for a certain measure. No, He did it completely. Now we come to the law of punishment for zina. The old law in the Torah was stoning to death. And Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam enforced that law, and people were stoned to death. Why did he do it? How did this happen? I'll take another 10 minutes to tell you that story. I don't have the time. Some of you may have heard me talk about it. But the important thing is that when he enforced the law of stoning to death, he did so on the basis of the law which was in the Torah. And then came down a law in the Quran which abrogated or cancelled the old law and replaced it with a new law, which is now a public flogging. The problem we face is that there are a hadith in Sahih Bukhari which declare that no, the abrogation or cancelling was not 100%. It was only 50%. And that is that if you are unmarried, the new law will apply. But if you are married, the old law will apply. These ahadiths are in conflict with the Quran. What do you do when there's a conflict between ahadiths and the Quran? The answer is that you stay with the Quran. But there will be some people who will want to argue and argue and argue and condemn you and want to declare that you are wicked in saying these things. You must show patience and patience and patience. And when you've shown enough patience with such people, then you challenge them. Okay, if you are rightly guided and I am misguided on this issue, you bring your wives and bring your children, and I'll bring my wives and I'll bring my children, and let us invite the curse of Allah on whoever is wrong. Come on. Come on. If you are so certain that your position is correct, come on and take the challenge. Don't do this. Don't do this with your brothers. No, try to save them. Show patience and patience and patience. And you'll only resort to this when there is no other option. When you resort to this, you must have the absolute confidence in your heart that this is the right position. Otherwise, don't do it. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام تبارك ربنا وتعاليت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعفنا وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وعلى أصحابه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته جماعة المسلمين Yes, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said من لم يذكر الناس لم يذكر الله If we don't show our gratitude towards the human race If we won't show our gratitude towards Allah تعالى On behalf of the جماعة of Woodlands in Switzerland We want to thank Sheikh Imran inspiring words And we would like, inshallah, next time we come to Cape Town again, inshallah, to visit our house.
Amen. Shukran. Allahu Akbar.